Okay, you want to
start up? Yeah.
Okay, we're going to start. So first let me ask, like, too loud? Should I bring it down a little bit? If I was reading, which I am, or reciting, okay, so is that, you want it down a little bit more? Or does that seem okay? It's okay? I'm fine. Anyway, so really quick introduction. I like to write things very personal from the heart, and a lot of stuff to do with nature. But this one turned out different. I was just wondering about guys who work on their cars all the time and their wives who are wondering, why is he tinkering in the garage all the time and so in love with that car? And then I had this idea of he dies and and when his wife thinks of him, she thinks of him dead, but like driving his car in like heaven, you know. And I thought, well, what's that bond with your love for that thing you want to tinker with so much, you know? And this poem turned into something completely different, but that's where it started. And it's not really a poem, it's a story. So I'm just going to do one thing tonight because it's long. I'll pause throughout. It's 18 minutes. And I drive to the city, so I have an hour and a half commute. So I have time to like, duh, what am I? So I had the book there and I memorized it and I thought, I can't do this. And I thought, well, let me just try a page or a paragraph, and I finally got it. So, you know, I'm kind of excited to recite to you guys. So let me just have a drink of this. And most of you know me, but my name is Jeff Edrich. Okay, here we go. This is called The Galaxy. I do it with a country accent. I don't know why that happened, but I wrote it and it was done. And then I just had this little notion hit me to try it with a country accent. And somehow it just became better, like in a big way. And I think it's because sometimes country speak seems simple. So to say something regarding life and, you know, profound with that simple sort of country way of delivering it sort of gives it more of a power. Anyway, that's how it felt to me. So here we go, The Galaxy. I guess we're made to look straight ahead. We don't look up much, sky, stars at night. Always thinking about the next deal or the next meal. Willing to fight for it too. Gotta keep looking straight ahead. That's how we're made. So I don't know what's wrong with me, but I keep looking up all them stars at night. Do you know our sun's a star? Our own star right here. Come around every day, make a whole world full of grass, kids running in hard gray factories, shaping metal into cars and bombs and killing each other. Just can't fit in my head sometimes. So I look up thinking, it'll come to me. One time, I just made it all up. I went up there, stirred them stars real good, just like I was in the kitchen. Then I spread them out all over, like I was a farmer. Spread them out over the whole field. I called it something, galaxy. There you go. They liked that name. Slapped it on some car way back. Had white walls, all shiny-like. Fancy dashboard. Galaxy. Like you in outer space. Like you knowed everything driving that car down the road. Nah, couldn't top that. Well, for a minute anyway. Gone now, just like everything. My kids blowed some bubbles. I was just laying on the grass looking up. Like I say, we all don't look up much. And they was laughing. I saw them bubbles float by. I thought, what if you was in one of them? Like them stars you don't know nothing about. But looking close, like right here. It's the god dang earth with all everything. Maybe there's a bubble with Emma about to have her baby. And Rick holding his M16 about to blow someone's head off. And of course, one with us where we is right now on Grandma's porch. I'd hold them all, fix the broke ones, maybe smile some. But you know the deal. Ain't but a few seconds and they gone. So anyway, I take this old galaxy out the junkyard, fix her up good. Don't know why, just something underneath pushing. I bring her back from the dead, all shiny like. I figure maybe the car God will fix me up good when it's time. I get some gas, and a rough old cowboy come over, stands a ways off staring. Has to break through his own hardened crust, I guess. Something about the car hooked him good. He stares like he's looking at his whole life and counting everything ever happened from the front bumper to the back. Just finished this morning. Maiden voyage, I said. Two piercing blue eyes look like ice water, as if he assessing the price of cattle. Bill, he said. The man had some rough hands. Steve, I said. He coughed, held up his palm in a gesture of, wait a minute, shaking his head with the cough. The gas station man helped a woman at the pump. Some bird liked to take my head off, lit so close. He look at the car again, gets to talking. My date in this car right here came the love of my life. Arcade squeezing in the back seat, trips to Ma and Pa's. Spilling ketchup and fries everywhere, laughing until their socks fell off. The stain finally come out and my kids crying when I had to get a new car. So many memories in this one. But then he stopped, had to catch his breath. You okay, I asked. He stared, kind of crushed in like. What color's your car for you fixed it? Holy shit. Light blue, I said. Jesus, I never told no one. Towed that old wreck home. In the trunk, someone scratched something inside. I was mad as a mule. What stupid fool done that? But then I looked. Was a heart, and inside it said, I love you, Jenny. Oh my God, I wondered, is this old cowboy that done that? hell? I just come in and get some gas. I asked him again, you all right now? He shook his head like a weak old thing, but his voice came out good. Yeah, I'm fine. I walked over to the trunk, put the key in. Before I turned it, I said, all right, because I knew his life about to spill right out. Morning lit up them words. He didn't say nothing. Go ahead, I said. He stared, moved his hand close, touched him like her face, and said, Jenny, hey, sweetie, he smiled, touched her name again. Something right grabbed my insides. I had to look at the ground, swallow hard. Darling, you please hand me the sugar. And your hands touched, and you looked at each other, and kids ran up the hill in summer screaming their kites crazy high, and breakfast pancakes, the kitchen full of butter sizzling in the pan, and coffee steaming out hot like when she poured it in your cup. And don't forget heat syrup, and I want chocolate chips in mine. And holding hands saying, thank you, God, for Mommy and Sean and Jane and pancakes. Amen. Everybody laughed so hard they cried. And you said, I want the biggest one because I'm the boss. He just dropped his head. Hung there like he wasn't no one. She's there, talking quiet, running through. I heard it. I don't know what she's saying, but it's something like, I love you, Bill. Ain't no words to figure. The other side, open, wide as a field. You can't hear nothing, but everything is there, frozen like. Can't reckon if you're breathing. Gas pump clicked off. This moment was done. Pulled himself up. He's with her. Took a breath. Coughed. Gestured with his head. I put this here so she'd see it every time she opened the trunk. I couldn't erase it, I said. No, you can't never erase that. And looked at the ground. I waited. Little voice in my head said, put the gas handle back on the pump. I did. The old cowboy closed the trunk slow, as if there was some sort of holy thing in there. He stepped away and looked up. Two birds flew above the trees. We watched them trail out till we couldn't see him no more. He's different now, silent, like some cowboy who knows about the river and how it run, about birthing calf in the field and putting them down when it's time. Now, you gotta be gentle when you clutch in the first gear with this baby. I know, I said. And you don't want to take a turn too hard. She'll roll like a barrel. I shook my head, yes. And you want to keep a good check on the distributor timing, but it sounds like she's running fine. She is, I answered. All right then, you take care of her now. He looked at me and then the car. Hope you're as lucky as I was. I held back a wave of something. He shook my hand, his rough palm pressing a memory of his life into mine, and said, yep, that's about right. He stepped back, looked again. "Now you get out of here, okay?" I said, "You bet." And felt I was leaving my father and my brother, that I was the shining bubble that would break and never come back. I kept thinking what this man named Bill looked like when he saw the scratches in the trunk of this old galaxy, that he wanted something so bad that it come to him again. How it come to be then that his road come this way? Way down in the water of everything, something deep must have moved, brought me here. And then, of course, I look up. I always do. And the farmer opens the sluice again, raining the dream of Bill's life all over me, pouring out the steering wheel and the dashboard. And I remember the date that came the love of his life, his kids squeezing in the back seat, trips to Ma and Pa's, spilling ketchup and fries everywhere, laughing, and how the stain finally come out, and his kids crying when he had to get a new car, and stood round waving, "Bye, galaxy." And he beeped the horn so it's like the car saying, "Goodbye," back all the way down the road. I'm in Bill's car now with his wife and kids, and I'll never see him again. I hear the voice of his wife, Jenny. She calls my name.
"Stephen." I burst out in tears and pull over. I sit there in the car till the sun melts our lives into a river. And somehow, a smile comes to my face. And I put the old galaxy in gear and press on the gas. I guess we're made to look straight ahead. We don't look up much. Sky, stars at night. Always thinking about the next meal or the next deal. And willing to fight for it too. Gotta keep looking straight ahead. That's how we're made. So I know what's wrong with me. I keep looking up. I keep looking.
Ready to go?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm Steve Haggerty, and my book is called Cows in the Fog. I'm working on a second book, but usually, you know, when you write a book, you read different parts like for a whole year, so That's good. We have a lot of new people here. So last time that I read here, Jeff accused me of talking too long, and this time I think he talked too long, so I tried to shorten mine, but that's okay. So just a couple remarks. You know, my opinion, to be effective as a writer, we need to find our own voice, probably in any art. So after journalism school, I thought I'd write like John Irving or J.D. Salinger or, you know, Hunter S. Thompson, that sort of spirited fellow. And it wasn't to be. So instead, I took me a long some years to get back to myself, you know, who I really am. And Vinny was instrumental in that because he kind of picked out what I was good at as a mentor and told me to go with it. All right, so my early influences, I grew up in the same community as three great American artists. And some of you might know Cambridge, New York, West Arlington, Vermont, Eagle Bridge, New York, and Shaftesbury, Vermont, Robert Frost, Anna, Grandma Moses, and Norman Rockwell. So grew up knowing people and knew these people quite well. And my parents both came from farm families, so you know, they were enthralled by, you know, this artist community. And but they all expressed that they wanted to connect with people with the feelings in their work. You could read Norman Rockwell talked about that at length. He needed to get the feeling in the picture to capture people. So I grew up doing dairy farm 3 months a year and really liked these three people. So but I also think it's important, like for me, I have to read a lot of poetry to read people today, like Billy Collins, Maya Angelou, and you know, there's a lot of other good people. So I kind of read half and half. Okay, so this one is called Will. This one flutters unharmed, merely tickled by the howling tempest. It drills up through concrete from beneath, finds the weakness in asphalt, pokes through, squeezes between curbs and sunken steel storm drains, roots itself in barren fields of sand, waits without fret for leaves in a tree bend to decay, survives in crawl spaces sealed off from light and rain, yanked between the flowers, rising sun till stars. It may reappear next week, but will lie and wait a century, if need be. It rides the wind, drops in gutters, sprouts in muck. And one day, a philanthropic breeze sweeps a fertile field, and woven heads of timothy rise and sway like freedom flags, smiling at those who tempted to root them out. Who, tell me who, has the will of grass? Okay, now, so in this little town there, there's a number of families that go back to the 1700s. So this is about our neighbor who was a little kid, you know, worked on his dairy farm, and his family came there in the early 1700s. And and he just died a few years ago. So he really had the whole history in him, and he's an interesting guy. Okay. So this is called Holding the Farmer to Hill. Outside a sprinkling of country rain, I watch through our bubbled wavy pane. Out across the narrow graveled road, the same where Ethan Allen's boys strode. Above the valley is a steeply grade, now trees and brush, scarcely a blade. But as a boy, it was one long cover of green where I'd behold the farmer and mowing machine. I would squirm as I exerted the child's will to hold the crawling sideways tractor to the hill. I was unaware I possessed no force to bind, not yet versed in the limits of human mind. He must have thought the thrill worth the chance. Apparently so, he would continue his advance To this day, I can't help but shudder when I wonder, what if my friend and tractor had gone asunder? If only I could have had some way to know, to leave him to go where he had to mow, how I have learned the ends of my power, which diminishes year by year, hour by hour. Okay. And then, you know, it's funny, I'm sure Jeff and other people experience, you write a book of poems and you think, you know, or I think in my own mind, oh, I have this one I really did well, I like, and something, then somebody will come up and pick out one I spent 5 minutes on just as kind of a thing to throw in the book, and it's funny that, you know, what people like. So this is called Long Story Short, and I'm both the writer of it and one of the people in it. I see him in town periodically. This man has quite the gift of gab, you see. To listen to him robs all of my strength, and trees wither he rambles for such length. One day he spotted me, and I feared. As he followed me in the deli, he declared, I will make a long story short. I could not help but think, what a good sport. He did indeed edit this tale well. I could not help but think his company swell. Oh, but the rascal crammed in five more, and I hightailed for the exit door. Okay, and then another one I haven't read. So we'll see how this one goes. It's called Good Grief. I welcome you, sir. I am Jerry B., human resources for this company. We must discuss all those days out. Your reasons are good, I have no doubt. Yours has been a life of trauma for years, so you must have cried a river of tears. There are so many on your list of dear departed. Those three fell on Everest. That's how it started. Most deaths unrelated, no one catastrophe. A horrible streak of luck. God help is our plea. Those aunts and seven uncles passed on too. The firm has joined in grieving beside you. Your three old grannies and those three gramps gone, and two lovely aunts, the sisters both Dawn. I have heard of siblings having first names the same. With sons, the boxer foreman played that game. I'm told one died on a plane, another on a cruise, two singing in a chorus, two of the blues. The heart attack snapped bungee cords, crashing cars, two creamed by asteroids, kissing under stars. Just let me offer this for those you love. Be cautious on Sunday, pray to God above. For the grim reaper takes yours that day, and it's Friday morns, you follow hearses away. You working amid such grief, plain unjust. We are letting you go, we feel we must. So this plain paper explains your termination, severance, and a planned vacation of fun. You will have yourself a jolly good time, commencing with a Mount Everest climb. And if you come down, you will not be bored with unlimited jumps on a bungee cord. So. Okay, and then this one is called Dappled Windows. Okay. We are hundreds in this school of fish of many colors, swimming over the highway, beneath the blackened underbellies of whale clouds cruising. The bellies burst and rain pounds my hood and spatters off my windshield as the storm attacks the earth. With such force, I pull off the road. My wipers thud furiously and I am relieved to silence them. I open the window a crack and the faint smell of asphalt rises with the steam of rain meeting the hot road. Enclosed in a cozy veil, gray. I am hidden from the world by resting inside the tempest. Fat rocks drops dapple my windows, and I wipe the fog from inside the glass to watch rainwater flooding puddles and gushing down mounds. Nature sways under the attack, and the landscape blurs like an impressionist painting that invites me to sit and take it in for a while. Too soon the downpour is over. I watch the whale clouds with underbellies turned silver move along and lead me back to realism. Okay, so I made a choice. I think I'll read this one that probably edited like, I don't know, 15 times or something. Jeff helped me with it. Sometimes if you get a poem, you have too much going on, just like a picture or something, that it part of it kind of overshadows the main theme, you know, then you have to go back. You know, that's what I did to, you know, make it a one-theme poem. So it's called The Turkey Vulture. And, okay. You are a king of the sky this morning, gliding below the blue expanse, your wide brown wingspread stretched, eyes peering downward at the forest. You circle, poised to swoop, but created to take only the dead or frail. Bronze breast plump and proud, rounded feathers edged in gold under heaven's streaming light. Your wingtips silver, steer while scoping the brush between the groves. A mere tilt steadies your span. Later, we meet on a country road. You are no longer a king, but a beggar instead. In my lane, pecking carrion, perched upon the putrid mound, and now your plumage appears gray, like the sky before its end. In a shady tunnel under tender branches, innocent light pokes through, your dark side suddenly exposed. You are someone I thought I knew. Begrudgingly, you pull your featherless pink head from the hole you have pecked in that black striped carcass, but you hold your place and defy me with black eyes. Dining hour would have been so much less complicated had this raccoon exhaled its last breath in a quiet meadow. Life is hard enough. Why must nature torment you, serving your meal in the middle of the road? My wheels draw closer and I fear I will run you over. You wouldn't risk death for a meal now, would you? Nonchalant in this pointless game of dare, despite my tire's crushing power, you eyeball me and sparse springy hairs of white bristle on that pink head above your puffed breast. What incongruity! Is it by design or by trick of nature that this peculiar head of yours is suited for the shape of a turkey, not as a crown for your noble body? If your tiny pink head weren't running the show, perhaps you wouldn't be so desperate to eat meals in the road. But who am I to judge? Your labor is honorable as mine. Move, I holler, move. But you just don't care. And now it may be too late. I stomp on the brakes and my car screeches to a halt. You reluctantly flap thrice and your gangly wings, once gilded with gold, as you circled under that blue expanse, struggle to lift you off to the side of the road. Your eyes follow me as I pass, and we both know that we are all beggar and king. Okay, so I guess one very short one, and then another short one. Never like to cram a lot of them in. It's better, I think, to read less than try to cram a whole bunch in. So Because, you know, to get the feeling across, if it starts going too fast, to me it doesn't work. But this is called Lunging Pecs. This is called an image poem. It's kind of a simple thing where it's like a painting of a picture. A lone wild turkey, constricted by the deep freeze, nearly topples, taking lunging pecks at a cornstalk stub, peeking above a desolate sea of white. Okay, this one, this is called The Brook Moves to Live. In exhaustion, unable to rise, the comatose forest lies under a white sheet, covering from meadows to mountaintops. Any view. Of all today, only the brook seems to know to move is to live. How can I not notice its deepest spirit rises to a roar where it rides the commotion of its journey's roughest spots, where it looks like it might succumb to ice creeping from the shore. The rapids shout to the pooling, giving in. Keep moving. Babble if you can do no more. Babble. Babble onward. The lake over my shoulder rests in one spot, and I surmise its lid closed over when in lethargy it contemplated what keeps life alive. All right, well, thank you very much for allowing me to read. Thanks.
What? Maybe 10 to 15 minute break. Stretch.
Okay. Now, we do have books for sale. There's 4 different ones of us reading, so if anybody's interested.
Okay, my name is Jay Erickson. I live in Pauling, just up the road. And just want to thank Larry for putting this together, and Jeanette and Front Street Gallery and Steve and Jeff and everybody for coming tonight. I really appreciate it, the opportunity to share some poetry. So I'm going to read some poems from this book I put out this year. But before that, I'm going to read some poems that are not in that book. And this one I thought was good. This was written right around the solstice, although you wouldn't know it based on the weather, but we're on the cusp of it. And when I first met my wife, she had an apartment in Paris, which I found pretty alluring. And I was in the pro column. And so this was about the night she had to sell it, and she lived there for a number of years, and we were there packing up. So this is poem is in 2 parts. Part 1, it's called City of Light. Poem. We woke in the longest night, when the earth swallows the light of the moon, and even the fuses refuse to cooperate, deepening the darkness that filled your old apartment in Paris. We took our last cafe creme and said goodbye to Rue Soleil, the street that nurtured your loves and in its narrow way led you to me. Part 2. This is a couple days later. We are at your mother's farm now, coaxing the light back into the world, listening to the drum of history and tracing the silver lines of family that run through you, bind you, cut you, hold you. I feel our line pulling taut, gathering the strength upon which we can balance and walk through the forever seesaw of dusk and dawn until the emptiness below is filled, and we can lie down, light swallowing dark, swallowing light. So that's that. A couple years later, fast forward, we're here, and we ended up buying some land in the neighborhood with these guys, and building a house, and I wrote that during that time. We are building a magic, an earth magic, a ground magic, a place to attract magis, birds and bees, and scuff knees, and reasons to breathe, and voluminous sighs, reasons to rise in misty mornings, in flowery forlornings of seed I will plant between your thighs. This one is called Picking Apples, and a friend of mine is a cider maker in Western Massachusetts, and his father, 20 years ago, decided to plant old cider varietals. People used to drink cider in this country 100 years ago the way that they drink beer now. And when people stopped doing that, the cider, the apple trees, the strains changed and they became more for eating and making pies, but there used to be an incredible variety of cider apple strains of apple trees. And these guys, my friend's father went to Cornell where they had saved cuttings and all these old varietals, and they found a bunch of old cider varieties and planted them and have built this amazing artisanal cider making business called West County Cider. And my friend's father was in the fermentation room a few years ago, and the pressure had built up in one of the tanks, and in a freak accident, a bolt came off, hit him in the back of the head, and he was killed. So at his memorial, which was a beautiful celebration of his life, someone quoted this Greek proverb that says, "Society grows great when old men plant trees whose shade they know they shall never sit in." And that was in the summer. And then in the fall, a bunch of us came back to pick. And I wrote that during that time. It's called Picking Apples. With each twist, I hope for the crisp dislocation of fruit from tree. This taut harvest of red, yellow, orange, umber fruit. My picking basket laden, hanging from my tired shoulders, laden with sweetness and the bitter that will bear the deepest cider of the hill. We move through the rows, a handful of hearts that beat with the memory of men who plant trees whose shade they will never see. So this one I wrote just the other day, week or two ago. And painting here with the moon and the trees is very reminiscent of the image that I tried to capture in this poem. And I was up very early with my one-year-old daughter, and it was just the two of us, and it was just the very beginning of the day. And it was a beautiful little moment, and I tried to write it down. We stand at the window and watch the purple dawn sky. Sickle moon in a slow dance with the only star left. I hold your small, smooth body against my chest, your weight on my hip. A hoarfrost lies atop the field, silent gray-white blanket holding the dead, dry stalk still. Sycamore reaches Venus in black silhouette, thick branch holding the outline of an owl. It silently watches the cat returning from her bloody nocturne, while the sun's fingers begin to reach across the clearing to melt time and thought back into the world. So I'm gonna switch gears and read some poems from this little volume here. It's called Bloom. And summer of 2013, was diagnosed with advanced testicular cancer, and part of my survival mechanism during that period to make sense of it, it was very hard to make sense of it. I'm still making sense of it. I'm fine now, I'm healthy. within a week of being diagnosed, I was in the ICU at Sloan Kettering coughing up blood. It had metastasized and was all throughout my body. So it was, nothing made any sense. And so I grasped for poetry to help me make sense of it. And I was first writing for myself and then writing to try and communicate with friends and families what was going on. And then I got involved in a program at Sloan Kettering called Visible Ink, and that one thing led to another, and ended up publishing this book. So that's some of the context, and I'm just going to read a few from this book. And my poems tend to be relatively short, and they also, I don't tend to title them. Occasionally I will. Mostly they're just dates or numbers. I'm not a big fan of titles, so these are all just numbered. This is one. I dreamt I became salt and was thrown as a fistful into the ocean, dissolving, returning, remembering. Today I will nod at acquaintances, open the mail to be disappointed by corporate come-ons, eat my tuna salad sandwich, move through this unsuspecting day, wondering how a man can become a fistful of salt. Six. Let this surprising wind bend me. May it strip a few leaves and crack finger-sized wood. But leave me this trunk and these roots. I am not done with them yet. We have more suns to reach for, more earth to hold. Wow, time goes pretty fast when you're reading poetry. I meant to say I wanted to invite anyone to just like ask any questions or any comments and have it be interactive. So if there's any thought, questions or anything, that's fine. If there's not.
The one you just read about this pure earth is full of salt, that just seems so true. I mean, we all end up who knows where, but we dissolve, and that it's good to be reminded of, you know, how temporary our experience is here.
Yeah.
This helps to appreciate life more, to be reminded of that.
Sure, sure.
You know, I am reminded by that image of the woman in the Bible. It may have been Abraham's daughter, who turned to look.
Lot's wife.
Lot's wife.
Yeah.
And that's how she did it.
Right.
She, you know, she lost her faith and had to have a look and became a pillar of salt.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what that image mm-hmm. reminded me of. I also like the image, the outline of an owl.
Mm-hmm. That just sounds good, right? Outline
right,
of an owl.
I
yeah,
see
yeah.
That
yeah.
Outline.
And you can see it, yeah, right. Especially with
the
backdrop.
It reminds me of potato chip. I guess.
Right. Okay, I just want to read a couple more, if I may. This is sort of in the hopes that we might actually get some snow soon. This is 19. The first snow comes like a benediction, a silent prayer pouring out of the sky, a soft white hand laid upon the land to forgive us and let us rest. The robins and waxwings join the great hush, waiting in this grateful parenthetical before they rise from the maples and resume their journey south. Okay, I did want to.
While you're looking for your next poem, I just wanted to say that the thing that the poetry does, and that poem in particular, is in life, you have a feeling and you want to say what the feeling is, but you can't say it
mm-hmm.
because you don't know. And you just said it. Seeing that white snow like that, that's exactly the answer. Those are the words that I want to say, but I never, until you just wrote it, that's the feeling.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so.
Which is why it was helpful when my world was made no sense. Like this was the only way I could make any kind of sense of it because I couldn't do it with my rational mind at all. You know? So it's like there's certain, in painting, all art I think has the power to capture things that can't be captured otherwise. Yeah, I so agree. And I'm so grateful for the medium because of that. What? All right. Can I go a little bit over? Okay. Well, I had three more that I want to read. Is that okay? Because they kind of make sense together.
Yeah,
yeah. Fine. Go ahead. Okay, so I'm going to... I'm just going to warn you, like, this experience was not that long ago, and I might, you know, cry. That's okay. I'm just warning you. So I had 3 months of chemo that was fairly intense. I had a bunch of surgeries. The first surgery I had was pretty intense, where they, it's called a retroperitoneal lymph node dissection, where they cut me from my sternum to my pubic bone, which as much as you can cut someone without breaking their bones. They took all of my intestines out, put them on my chest, and then they took all the lymph nodes out of my abdomen. So I'm just needing to tell you that because this was I wrote this poem the night before that was about to happen. And then I'm gonna read you the poem that I wrote after. So it's like a before and after exercise. I wonder what they will find when they open me up. The usual crowd, intestines, kidneys, muscles, liver, bladder, et al. Cancer, dead. A fragment of that amazing almond croissant from last Sunday. The Firebird matchbox car I could never find. Yellow flames on the red hood. All of the good intentions that I have forgotten. Snapshots of bleary-eyed teenagers watching an unexpected dawn. A fierce love so overwhelming it is unspeakable. A McDonald's cheeseburger. A half-written play concerning tree planters in Florida. A dream of holding my child. A dream of holding my child on a sunny winter morning. One AAA battery, two fully arranged songs, three leather pouches filled with gratitude, light, and grief. A memory of her, a map. The other thing about poetry as a writer is it can take you right back to that moment. It can be powerful. So this was a while after that, and I would, you know, after a big surgery like that, they want you to walk as much as possible, so I would sort of hobble down my driveway as much as I could a few times a day, and I would, so this is sort of the context.
Yeah.
We walked slowly this morning along a tongue of dry gray gravel snaking through a white and peaceful field. We pass a rare coalition of robins. They are combing the brush for the few remaining berries. We pause at a small mess of fur and blood, still red. It must have been last night's kill. Rabbit, maybe. Small canine tracks leave the scene. Musky fox smell suspended in the sharp air. On our way back, we find some digestive part frozen like a rock. When I walked into the operating room, no glasses and blind with fear. Bustling green and blue figures barely looked up, their faces hidden. Perhaps it is better that way. I could not pick them out of a lineup. Or the mug books that are sometimes shown when someone has been gutted. The table was so flat, with two arms extending out, straps waiting to hold me in place. Maybe even when your mind is held in the cool, clear nothingness and the under of anesthesia, the body still struggles against so deep a wound. Animal avatar flailing to be free. Now I see the weeks plod past the window from my bed. The pain of places that were incised, clamped, spread, cleaved, excised, sliced, sewn. Blood sacrifice, memory and fragments like church bells rung in a sacred act. This is my last poem, and this is the epilogue to this. And most of my poems are usually like, there's one feeling or one image I'm trying to get out. And then this epilogue, I was trying to kind of sum it all up, which was first was like, okay, I can't, that's impossible. And then I just tried, and I just was writing and just writing and writing, and I started to pick out some themes. And so this is a first poem that I ever really wrote, which was had a little more beyond the scope of a sort of a singular image and feeling or a set. There was more of a summation. This is the epilogue. So thanks everyone for coming tonight. Okay, I'm gonna show you one more thing. This is audio visual.
I was going to ask you.
Okay, so while bathroom break, this is just explaining this context. So this, after I was declared, you know, clear and free, after my last treatment, I've never had a tattoo before. And so, you know, a little over a year ago, I went into a tattoo parlor and got this tattooed on my center of my heart chakra. So it's really in the center of my heart. And this is the Sanskrit word jai, which means hallelujah or victory. So that's something to know as you listen to this poem. Okay, sure. Funny little story about that. I'm getting tattooed, and it's a parlor, and there's multiple ways. And another tattoo artist walks by, and I'm in the chair like this, and I'm playing back the whole year of treatment in my head, and I'm weeping, in just like this mixture of gratitude and just all of it just coming, you know. And of course, I had been through pain. This was like walk in the park pain, you know. So, but I'm weeping from these emotions, and the guy walks by and he says, "Oh yeah, that's a tough spot, man. Tough spot." And I wanted to be like, but no, because this is not. So, that was a funny moment. There was a tattoo on my heart when I heard the coyote call. When your mother took the medicine from the bear. When the turtle moved slowly across the moonlit sand and showed us how to place an egg. When the dove became an eagle and found my breath that was slipping away. There was a tattoo on my heart when I heard the news, felt the finity of time, and began to rehearse the inevitable goodbyes. There was a tattoo on my heart, blue-black ink born in my loin, unfurled through my center, feathery bloom in my lungs until it reached my heart, hidden until pain and desperate love worked away the hardening veil. There was a tattoo on my heart when I became an oyster, and the star Swati rose, and I rose through the water to capture a drop of rain and sink down again to be serenaded by whales while the drop becomes a pearl. There was a tattoo on my heart when I saw the surgeon lift you out, bloody as the dark bloom that was lifted out of me. There is a hallelujah on my heart. That can be heard on the plain where ecstasy and sorrow dissolve into each other, and reason is sobered until we fall down drunk and can taste ourselves being tasted and feel ourselves being breathed. There is a song on my heart, always playing, waiting to be unmuted and drown out the sound of the sharp tube against my ribs as the surgeon seeks the unfilled space in my lung. There is a light in your eyes that comes from the still obsidian center of being where the arrow becomes the bow and the sun becomes the moon and where hundreds of needles and tubes and staples and shaking and fever and burning pain fade to white. There is a tattoo on your heart, drawn from the same inkwell as mine, a hallelujah waiting to be heard. I put my ear against your tiny chest. to listen and close my eyes, unfurl and bloom again. Thank you.
Jay, thanks for that. That was amazing. I followed Jay's story kind of from the beginning. And I think he had the same type of cancer that Lance Armstrong had. And when I found out he had it, I thought to myself, man, if anyone could beat this thing, he can. So, what a great story. And I told him so. Outside Vinny's Deli, you remember that thing? So, anyway, my name's Larry Hayes. I live here in Pawling. My wife is the lovely Victoria. My two daughters, Sophia and Anna, are here, thankfully. I grew up in Westport, Connecticut. That's always kind of uncomfortable to admit these days because it got taken over by bankers and gangsters a number of years ago. Never used to be that way. My father was a newspaper reporter for the Bridgeport Post. My mom was a nurse, and it was a very middle-class town back then. It was a very cool town. Anyway, so I grew up in that area. My grandfather, when I was old enough to be visiting and back and forth, he was in Bridgeport at the time. And he had had a couple of grocery stores in Lower Westchester until the Great Depression. I think he had a store in Pelham, maybe one in Rye. And when Vicki and I got married, we moved into a house on Grace Church Street in Rye, beautiful old big gray elephant of a house. And we later found out that my grandfather lived on the same street. Anyway, he lost the stores and eventually became a beer distributor in Bridgeport. This is back in the days of Schlitz and Schmitz and all those old great New York brands. And I have great memories of visiting him at his house in Bridgeport. He had a pretty nice house. He'd go down in the basement, he had one of those little tiny pool tables. And I remember that Seinfeld episode where they have little tiny pool tables and you're always hitting the cue against the wall. But he had all that great old bar paraphernalia. All the lights and all the schmaltzy stuff, all the kitschy shit. It was very cool. It was our favorite place to hang. Anyway, this poem was about him. His name was Curly Hayes, and I think I was 10 years old in this poem. The only other thing you have to know is that he loved baseball, and he used to come to Westport on Sundays with these boxes of three-fingered baseball gloves. These ancient, ancient gloves that looked like big, fat leather pancakes and did not resemble anything like the modern glove. But anyway, there's a reference to that in the poem. Curly Hayes. When I was still seven and safe in the suburbs, tossing papers from my modified Schwinn, my grandfather was running beer in Bridgeport. A gun tucked under his seat. His route took him through the toughest parts of town, places with names like Father Panic Village, streets no white would dare walk at night. Maybe this is what made him twitch in his sleep. In his last days, lean, gray, and angry, from his bed of slow cancer to scare sister with some strange, harsh speech. Father never let us see him after that, and we never asked. Grandpa, I'd rather remember you come visiting on Sundays in your slick shoes and sweet Irish tie, bearing boxes of three-fingered mitts. Your voice had a boom and a cackle then. I know now why they called a bald man Curly. And in the backyard, we'd toss names like Musial and Gibson. The day I lost the autographed ball, you were the only one who said it wasn't everything. In 64, you brought me down to the series. Your loved ones, the Cardinals, had come to New York. No place to park. I remember the box you hid the hydrant in, some haggling, and the scalper's raw grin. We got stuck so far back in the bleachers, the players looked like mad-capped ants. I amused myself with binoculars and the smell of fresh beer when suddenly above us an old wizard appeared, leading children, a white beard to his knees. From a distance, they curled through the crowd like a snake. Then I saw what the old man was using for bait. Fistfuls of silver tossed, blind and winking, from an apron tied round his waist. Each time he flung his silver into the sun, the children scattered like mice. Lost the rest of the day in this flash of a dream, I miss Mantle slam one into the sky. And later, I was too sleepy to care about the ticket you tore with a grunt and a grin, muttering, no one pays a fine in New York City. I can't quite recall the rest of it. Most likely I slept at your side on the interstates, dozed in and out of your voice as you hummed, and we spun out of the city and into the onrushing night. So that was written way back in the 80s, early 80s. This was too. I graduated from the University of New Hampshire with a BA in 75, 76, and then decided, Vicki and I decided to go back in 80 to 81 to get a one-year master's degree in poetry writing. I was lucky enough to study with the poet Charles Simic, and then that year later, the second semester, McKeel McBride, who's a terrific woman poet. I mean, she has no advanced degrees, and she's a full tenured professor of poetry. She's just incredibly talented and enthusiastic, and she kind of made my year that year. Anyway, the backstory of this poem is we rented a cool farmhouse out above Bow Lake from a professor on sabbatical on 15 acres. And part of the deal was we took care of the family pets. He had an old German short-haired pointer named Mauser, great, great dog, and a little black cat named Dog. So Vicki and I lived with them for most of the year. And this poem kind of came out of that. It's called The Difference Between Cat and Dog. Two parts. Number one, the dog. A witch's brew, he is born of the grit of the earth. Rat belly, cow bone, the abandoned eye of the mole. In the dark, his toenails sprout like black teeth, gut grumbling like an impending earthquake. Because he has bad taste and cheap guilt and is at heart a two-bit subversive, the dog, once tamed and fed a boring diet, retaliates the only way he knows how, by smuggling rank winds from the bowels of dead weasels into the living space of unsuspecting humans. The older a dog gets, the stronger his attachments to the cycles of the earth. Thus, in his last days, the old dog grows fond of wood stoves and winter, and as if preparing himself for a long, solemn journey to another kingdom, slips into a cloak of pure snow. The cat. The cat, on the other hand, is sexy and shrewd, like the tough fledgling actress who will sleep with the fat shit director only to blind him with her dreams by morning. Her thick fur looks French, but is in fact the result of a time when the night mated with soft forest creatures. Some claim she is really an Egyptian brainchild, her dark coat once dipped in the ink of eclipse. In her sleep, the cat cultivates the tastes of an empress, pink silk scarves, midnight spankings, brunches of bouillabaisse and Turkish cigarettes. There is one thing we know for sure. Her eyes are a pair of green orbs, emerald planets from a galaxy far beyond speech. In that world, a glance kills and movement is sacred. That same year was the year, and 2 weeks ago was the 35-year anniversary of John Lennon's death, his shooting. And I don't know if you guys remember the weather that day in Central Park when they had the memorial, but it was very bizarre weather. Sun and then snow. So this is a very short memorial poem I wrote after I found out that apparently snow began to fall just after the 10-minute silence ended. Title, After 10-Minute Silence for John Lennon's Snow. It's very brief. Just as the silence in Central Park ended, just as the heavens began quilting our sighs, rare moment of presence on this nervous bastard earth, just then from the sky, an empty, silent sifting, the kiss of a quiet angel who pities us our prayers, white tears setting down on the cool, bruised cheek of the earth. This is a song about depression. Very short, fortunately. It's a pretty dark poem, but for some reason I like it. In that same time frame, a little later, a couple years later, I applied for Edna St. Vincent Millay has a colony, artist colony, right up the road here, about an hour up the road in Austerlitz. And I got in for a couple weeks, and it was not a particularly productive time for me, but I squeezed out this one. And I think it's about depression. It's called Understars. All night I'm lying under stars, trying to buy their beauty. Such pure, distant points of light, they seem to say, the earth is one hopeless little story. All day I rehearsed the old faithlessness, sang the same cracked song of the self. All I've wanted has grown to be a sick tree, from which the whole world has fallen. We are small here tonight on Earth, nearly helpless. The stars, as usual, have nothing more to say. And no light will touch the poem or the fruit, this human body curling in darkness. This is a more positive poem. Probably the closest to Buddhism I've ever gotten. It's almost more of a chant called Walking the Earth. It's multiple parts. I'll pause briefly between parts. Walking the Earth. A path curving into deep woods. A silence so thick and ancient it swallows trees as I go. The path twists and thickens. 200-year hemlocks surround me. A stand of native beech saplings shiver. In the darkest of these woods, I empty myself of seasons. Turn to the mute, quivering lives each silent step divides. Knowing myself neither shunned nor needed here. Here in the depths of a presence so strong, my breath is but a dampness it takes back and gives. A flower unfolding each finger of grief. Unfurling in the mist of whatever hush there was before the earth knew itself in my name. Before I walked these woods, carving myself in the wounds of an ancient tree. Relieved when finally the new healing wood came to curl over each slow darkening letter. Knowing somehow it was better this way. Wordless, covered, walking the earth without a name. So almost all those are old poems. This is a new one called Melancholy. Autumn, of course, is its season, dusk its time of day. Anything fleet and vanishing, footprints the red fox etched an hour ago in the morning dew. It ripens into the darkest of grapes, the deepest Merlot, sweet tears spilling on the banks of regret, that blessing you forgot to give or receive. Nectar of the poets, empty nest still warm in love leaving, night train headed through our bones in the dark. Thumbnail moon against the cobalt sky, distant buoys tilting to a foghorn out at sea. All we love or have loved in this life, tugging its sweet, sad saxophone. Each riff a play on time past and time passing. All right, this poem has multiple parts. I'm just going to read the first one because I think it's the strongest and it kind of gets across the point of the poem. Winter Climb, this is an old poem that I kind of rediscovered. I had forgotten I had even written it until a couple days ago when Vicky gave me a file of older stuff. Winter Climb. This day, a clear blue ship, I climb the fresh powdered mountain. Stand after stand of virgin white birch, some with their hair pinned to the ground, bent as if in weeping. Halfway up in a small striped maple, sewn to a lower branch, a little snow-peaked nest, twig weave of field hay and moss. Inside I find two tiny white scrolls, curled parchments of thin paper birch. Gloves off, I anxiously unroll them, half expecting hieroglyphics. Rolled out in my palm, of course, there was nothing, just the rich stain of inner orange bark. I'd still like to believe in that kind of miracle. Mysterious messages left by dark-throated birds, secrets sent in code from the other side. Hardest to hear sometimes are the clear notes of the given. How in an empty nest a cup of snow shines. All right, just one or two more. We'll wrap it up. Here's a Vietnam poem that I'm not going to read. It's just too dark. This one is for my wife. It's, again, an old poem that I forgot about. And I put a new ending on it, and hopefully she'll like it. It's called Late Prayer. Sometimes late at night, lying wide awake with you on the far edge of sleep, all at once I feel your whole body shudder, shifting through the slipping transmission of dreams. as if something deep inside of you were breaking. At times I get suddenly frightened, pull myself to you a little tighter, wishing somehow I could wake you or pray, or that closing my eyes, I might open some secret other eye. Sometimes that day in the rain returns, and I remember thinking how this should be enough. The matted leaves shining on stone, our history, a small black cat that shivers and settles between us. Tonight, after work, let's talk to each other. Huddled in the dirty Afghan. In the dim light, let's close the tired book between us. Imagine a new, kinder ending we'll work on tomorrow. The last poem is a memorial poem I wrote for our good friend Al Selvin. I don't think all of you know that we lost one of the great spirits in town here just a little over 2 months ago. Debbie is here. And I wrote this for Debbie and Jesse and Maggie, the kids. He died way too young, suddenly. So I wrote this for his memorial service, which was amazing. People showing up from as far away as Australia, giving testament to what a great soul Al was and is. So this is my effort called At Some Point in Time. And this will be the last poem of the evening. At some point in time, our tears will finally exhaust themselves. Souls wrung inside out. Spirit gone missing in this black pond of grief. At some point in time, all we hold dear will hold us dearly in the dark. At some point in time, sleep will come bearing its sack of old tunes. Memory will pull out its dog-eared songbook. Desire will put it all on shuffle play. At some point in time, all our tears will crystallize and harden, form a small, smooth stone we will pocket and palm the rest of our days. At some point in time, the soul will begin its slow stitching. Our numbness become an itching inside this tender new skin, our wound a faded bloom below. At some point in time, the full moon will finally bless us from behind this curtain of clouds, Earth's Eucharist hung in mystery and grace. At some point in time, the dark season will turn into a simple and beautiful autumn. The air will remind us to breathe. At some point in time, all our prayers will morph into shooting stars, lovely as they fall back to earth. At some point in time, we'll finally see our angels all around us everywhere, find our loved ones embedded in the deepest recesses of the heart. Thank you for coming.